Question from Dr. Soundappan. Incidence of COVID in rheumatoid arthritis patients.
In about the incidence of COVID in rheumatoid arthritis, I'm not sure how much is the percentage, what is available in literature now. But in case of rheumatoid arthritis, if they have already a feature of ground glass opacities, which are now a feature of COVID, these rheumatoid arthritis patients will also have those findings. If they have a old imaging, it will be very useful. We can see whether there is any new findings there. Or if it is old image is not available, still we depend upon RT-PCR on the final diagnosis. But still we have to give indeterminate type of COVID. That is what recommended now.
Okay, I think that does it. So thank you, Dr. Pranish. Excellent presentation. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, sir.
We go on to Dr. Priya's presentation. I think she is attempting screen share. Madam, you succeeded all the three times that you did. Would you like to do the screen share yourself? I'll have to find and unmute you. So please hold on. Okay, I have unmuted you. So could you please try to screen share? If you can't
yes,
get it, I can. Okay, you got it. Your screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
We have 47 participants right now. At the peak, we did have about 64, but there were about 5 or 6 who kept going out and coming back. And I think it was because of mobile signal not being available and various other issues. Even I had to go out and come back because my Wi-Fi wasn't working very well. Please go ahead, ma'am. Let me not stop.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone, and I thank Sir and EC for giving me an opportunity to present the guidelines that has been issued both by FOCSI and also some of the guidelines I've imported and given from RCOG as well in regard to pregnancy in the times of COVID. I'm Dr. Priya Kannan from Garbharakshambige Fertility Center, Kodambakkam. As we know, the matters related to childbirth cannot be delayed, whether it's COVID or non-COVID. And it will be inevitable that in the near future that we will be caring for women infected with COVID-19 in pregnancy and for childbirth on a lot of basis, as opposed to now, which is very rare. The maternity healthcare providers and the facilities need to prepare for the situation with a view to prevent the consequences of the infection to the mother and her newborn and to the healthcare personnel as well. And hence, the objective of care would be to prevent the spread of infection from the infected woman to other pregnant women and the public at large, and to safeguard the healthcare providers and to keep themselves safe. And as we all know, just a reminder again that COVID is a notifiable disease. And on online, all our private institutions also have to log in and report this disease. The one thing that we all have to do at every visit a mother makes to the clinic is ask them the features of A, whether they have any symptoms of acute respiratory distress, or they've had any travel abroad, or have they come in contact with a person known with possible COVID infected person, or they have come in contact with a person who could have been in contact with a COVID infected person through any household contact or visitors or attending any events of such sort where the person could have been present. This has to be done at every visit. Even if she's making a visit today and tomorrow, both the visits, it has to be asked and made a note of in our records that this was asked and the answer was negative. The measures that we advise all the mothers is to practice social distancing, which is very common nowadays, but also the two most important things that we also remind the mothers is A, to avoid gathering and functions, especially the Valagappu, which is the 7th month milestone, which is a common cultural practice in our country, to do it as simple, in a simple way as possible, and to have as less people as possible, or like, you know, that's something they can't avoid, so to make them have it. The second is to minimize the visitors from coming in contact with the mother and the newborn after the delivery. Even now, for any visit, one patient is allowed to bring only one attender. And hence, during the delivery as well, we tell them that you can have one attender with you, probably two more on the rounds on a shift basis, but only one attender in a room. Hence, to reduce the amount of contact the patient and the mother and the newborn has with the with any other persons. Antenatal care, which has been a major question and something we have been having doubts on a daily basis, is how do we provide the antenatal care for our mothers? So the regulation now has said that the asymptomatic and uninfected women at present, the recommended strategy is to defer the routine visits. And hence, the doubts and consultations can be done telephonically or through a web platform for minor elements or questions. The two most important scans which needs to be done, which is a 12th week and 19 to 20 weeks. The 12th week is the NT scan and the 19 to 20 weeks is the target scan. Both the scans must be done. And after which, straight, if the patient does not have any other comorbidities that the patient, the mother needs to be taken care of, the next visit can be only at 32 weeks. After which, of course, the visit may have to be more regular and more frequent than before. But after 20 weeks, she can go straight to 32 weeks if there are no more comorbidities along for the mother. If the pregnant or the mother is a healthcare worker, then before 28 weeks of gestation, then the rule to follow is to follow the social distancing like all her colleagues. However, if a health worker is pregnant and about 28 weeks of gestation with any underlying disease, irrespective of the gestational age, then they may have to go in for more severe and hence strict social distancing, which might even be abstaining from work and being at home. The clinical presentation of COVID-19 in pregnancy, the pregnant women don't appear to be more susceptible to the consequences of COVID than the general population. And the exposure to the appearance of clinical features is the same as that of the population. And presentations can be asymptomatic, like any other in the general population, or those they can, or any pregnant woman who is associated with medical diseases such as diabetes or asthma may present with pneumonia and marked hypoxia. Whereas the immunocompromised and elderly pregnant women may also present with atypical features such as fatigue, malaise, body ache, GI symptoms such as nausea and diarrhea. Testing for COVID in pregnancy. A pregnant woman who's had acute respiratory illness with one of the following criteria, such as a history of travel abroad which was on March 6th, it was said 14 days. So hence now, anybody who's come in contact with any of the individuals who's also, or at least had a contact with the COVID positive, must be tested. Or if the mother is a close contact of a laboratory who is proven positive, or is a healthcare worker herself, or has been hospitalized with features of severe acute respiratory illness, then they must be tested. A pregnant woman who is presently asymptomatic should be tested 5 to 14 days of coming into direct contact or high-risk contact of an individual who is being tested positive for the infection. Right now, we just got this circular like few days ago, which said that the pregnant women residing in clusters or a containment area or in a large migration gathering or evacuees, which are hotspot districts presenting in labor or likely to deliver in the next 5 days, should be tested for COVID even if they are asymptomatic. And hence now, they are testing for all mothers who are most likely to go for a labor in the next 5 to 10 days. We are testing for COVID because we don't know when they might come with the emergency as well. And hence, we are going ahead. We've been asked to go ahead and test them. When, after testing, if they are found to be positive and not in labor, an asymptomatic woman, mother, should be quarantined in the hospital as per the practice, not in our hospital, but a hospital that has been marked to treat COVID positive patients. If symptomatic, the decision needs to be made as to require of hospitalization and further intensive care as per the general guidelines. There is no specific or different guidelines for pregnant women as such. Management of COVID positive in labor, the first thing that we need to do is inform the anesthetist and the pediatrician or the neonatologist that such a woman, the mother who is presenting in labor right now is a COVID positive, make all the healthcare worker involved also know that the mother is COVID positive, even if asymptomatic, and give appropriate protection, personal protection kits. That is the most important thing. And in an emergency where the PPE may not be available, I mean, this was given in our regulation from FOCSI, we must consider transferring the patient to a center which is better equipped. Right now, all COVID positives must be delivered in appropriate hospitals, not in our regular hospital. Even if I've been following her for all these 9 months, when she's found to be COVID positive, I must transfer her to either any of the hospital that is determined by the government to manage COVID positive patients. To manage a COVID positive patient in labor, there must be a separate delivery room and operation theaters which should be equipped as per the regulation that is given right now. Both the neonatal resuscitation corners should be at least 2 meters away from the delivery table. Resources required, such as the space, equipment, supplies, and trained healthcare providers for delivery, cesarean section, and neonatal resuscitation must be present. The standard facilities required for infection control in these areas should be same as that of any other suspect or confirmed COVID-19 infection patient. Regarding timing of delivery, there is no need to alter the timing of delivery based on the positive COVID-19 test. The presence of infection is not an indication to induce labor or deliver the woman. The exception to this would be a critically ill pregnant woman where delivery may be indicated to relieve the extra metabolic and pulmonary load. The possible benefits of delivering a mother in such a situation should be weighed against a possible risk of worsening the systemic status with a surgical intervention. When in labor, the one most important thing to do is to monitor using pulse oximetry and also look for the respiratory status, such as difficulty or shortness of breath, respiratory rate, pulse rate, and oxygen saturation on pulse oximetry should be along with other things such as the TOCO pressures and FH and everything. This is the most important another management to do in a COVID positive mother. Medical management, we've had an elaborate talk. So I would skip these two slides because we had elaborate talks, but I would really like to hear from our Dr. Eilerson, sir, about the application of the same drugs in a pregnant mother, because the study which studied the hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin on the 20 odd patients had pregnancy as an exclusion criteria. But the one thing that is good is that both the drugs we've been used in pregnancy and during breastfeeding previously for various other indications without any significant effects on the mother or the fetus. And the antiviral drugs, some of it also we have used extensively before, so we can still go ahead and use them if approved in pregnant mothers as well. As such, there is no, in regard to breastfeeding and COVID positive, there is no evidence that COVID-19 is secreted in the breast milk as of now, because the CDC states, we do not know whether mothers with COVID-19 can transmit virus via the breast milk. As of now, the most important risk factor for the newborn would be the close proximity of the newborn to the mother, which is likely to share the infective airborne droplets. On the effects of COVID-19 infection on mother and the fetus, the pregnant women do not appear to be more likely to be unwell other than than compared to the general population in terms of COVID-19. But however, if the pregnant woman has got comorbid conditions such as diabetes or hypertension, obesity, respiratory disease, or is of advanced maternal age, she's more likely to have a severe form of respiratory disease. In regard to vertical transmission, the infection is not transmitted from mother to child through placental transfer or through secretions in the genital tract, and hence vertical transmission does not seem to be there either by in utero or during labor natural. So the two reports, including a total of 18 women with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 pneumonia who delivered by either cesarean section, tested negative for coronavirus, and there were no traces of the virus in mother's amniotic fluid, cord blood, or in the breast milk. In regard to congenital anomalies, as of now, there is no evidence of any fetal effects of infection in terms of fetal abnormalities or fetal parameters of growth, amniotic fluid, or Doppler indices. As of now, there is no rationale for recommending amniocentesis to detect fetal infection at this time. An ultrasound 14 days after the infection can be considered for the pregnant woman who has recovered from the infection. Having said that, right now we have, when COVID started, probably we are yet to probably come to the stage where the first trimesters happened during November, December, Jan, and we are likely to do the target scan or the anomaly scan now and then see the newborns whose mothers had COVID positive in the first trimester. Only after studying those fetuses, we can definitely come to a definite conclusion. In regard to miscarriage, at present, there is no evidence of higher risk of abortion with COVID-19 infection. Preterm labor, at present, there is no evidence of higher risk of preterm labor with COVID-19 infection. However, as with any systemic disease which can compromise maternal health, there is a possibility that preterm labor may occur in these situations. When a woman presents in preterm labor, tocolysis is not indicated when the mother has been tested to be positive for COVID, as is the general principle of avoiding such an intervention in the presence of any systemic disease. This decision should be individualized depending on the degree of clinical severity of the infection. However, if there is a pulmonary involvement, beta mimetic drugs must be avoided. In regard to MTPs, abortion care is essential healthcare. It is well established that early abortions are safer for women, and MTP Act places limits on the gestational age for abortions. Hence, these services should continue to be provided by the public and private providers. In regard to fertility treatment, on 17-420, we had a guideline from ESHRAE. We don't have one from FOCSI, which advised that ESHRAE is a European society, and we have not got anything from FOCSI, which is the Indian OB-GYN society, which advised that assisted reproduction treatment should not be started at the present for following reasons: to avoid complications from assisted reproduction treatment in pregnancy, to avoid potential COVID positive related complications during pregnancy, to mitigate the unknown risk of vertical transmission in COVID positive patients, to support necessary reallocation of healthcare workers, to observe the current recommendations of social distancing. However, on 23-4, they issued another guideline which said that if at all somebody wants to start, there was like a 16-page guideline on all the newer good practice guidelines in terms of the lab, in the embryology lab, and in when dealing with the patient, interaction with the patient, how to go about it. But as of now, we are not recommending to start any fertility treatment. However, in cases of urgent fertility preservation in terms of oncology patients, the cryopreserved gametes, embryos, or tissue can still be considered. And for those who've just started the assisted reproduction treatment and are yet to have an embryo transfer, we recommend elective oocyte or embryo freezing and then consider transfer after the lockdown period or after we tide over this crisis. And infertility being a disease, the infection is decreasing. It can be restarted only for a clinical indication in line with the local recommendations. How do we deal with ectopic pregnancy in the times of COVID? The RCVOG has given a guideline that women with ectopic pregnancy should be managed in accordance with local protocols, with an emphasis on conservative management whenever possible. A medical management with a single dose of methotrexate C is the recommended treatment as of now for the ectopic pregnancies in COVID times. Having said all this, protection of the healthcare workers is the most important, which is distancing, use of appropriate PPE and chemoprophylaxis, and be as in the obstetric care, sometimes in the hurry of labor, which is going, which should be avoided. We should protect ourselves and all our staff, which is a big team, before we handle any, whether they are symptomatic, asymptomatic, tested asymptomatic, tested non-tested asymptomatic, every possible patient to be treated as COVID positive, and appropriate precautions to be taken. Thank you very much for this opportunity.